और गेस्ट स्पीकर डॉक्टर पीएस बनर्जी सर, प्रिंसिपल साइंटिस्ट एंड स्टेशन इंचार्ज आईवीआरआई ईस्टर्न रीजन कोलकाता। आई वेलकम यू ऑल यू सर इन दिस सेमिनार। आई वेलकम आवर डीन डॉक्टर जे के प्रसाद एंड आई ऑल्सो वेलकम अदर गेस्ट, अदर ऑडियंस, स्टूडेंट्स एंड माई डियर फ्रेंड्स। As we know, this is the day we are commemorating the anniversary of the man who was behind the development of rabies vaccine. So this World Zoonosis Day was celebrated to commemorate the day when it was first developed, the rabies vaccine, and human was vaccinated against the rabies. Sir, as the whole world is suffering with the present scenario of COVID-19 pandemic, and this is the very right time to, you can say, celebrate this day as the World Zoonosis Day, and to make the people, scientific and non-scientific, both type of people, to aware of the occurrence of zoonotic diseases. The day we are we see the emergence and re-emergence of different types of viral and bacterial disease according to parasitic disease. So Dr. Banerjee is with us and he will talk about the parasitic zoonosis, which is, I think, it is ignored in some way in and it is under neglected zoonosis also. Many of the parasites are there, we are in nature, but they are neglected. So Dr. Banerjee, he has graduated from Vidhan Chandra Krishi Vishwavidyalaya, Kolkata, and then he did his master from JNKV, Jabalpur, and he did his PhD from J.V. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology. He has vast experience of teaching and research in the field of, especially in the field of veterinary parasitology. He has more than 31 years of experience in teaching and research. He has contributed to different institution and sectors in different capacity. He has contributed to J.V. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology as a faculty in veterinary college. He worked at IVRI Izzatnagar as senior scientist, and he also shouldered the responsibility of head of department of veterinary parasitology IVRI and principal scientist. Presently, he is working at Eastern Regional Station for IVRI, Kolkata. He is working as station in charge there. Dr. Banerjee, he has many research publications with him, and he has published more than 150 research publications in different national and international journals of review. He has contributed a lot in books and book chapters. And Dr. Banerjee has handled so many projects, including one international project that he has handled at IVRI. And especially he is working in the area of molecular epidemiology and diagnostics of parasitic disease. With this introduction, I welcome Dr. Banerjee to be the guest speaker of the day on the parasitic zoonosis frequently encountered in animal but obscure in humans in India. I welcome, sir. Now I request our dean, Dr. J.K. Prasad, sir, to give his opening remarks on the presentation by Dr. Banerjee on world zoonosis.
Banerjee, sir, start over, right?
Thank you very much, Dr. Kaushik. Our today's learned speaker, Dr. P.S. Banerjee, a renowned parasitologist of the country, Dr. Veer Singh, DRI cum Dean PGS of our university, all the senior officers, our faculty members, the students. Kindly mute the mic, Dr. Kaushik, keep on muting the mic so that there should not be any kind of disturbance. So, all my faculty members, my dear students, So I welcome everyone in this important webinar, which is going to be conducted today on occasion of World Zoonosis Day. We know that our today's speaker, Dr. Banerjee, he is a well-known parasitologist of the country. And not only this, I am also adding something else, that he is also a very good sportsman and a very good event manager, because I got the opportunity to work with Dr. Banerjee in many of the teams, either related to the sports or related to the academics or related to the different kinds of cultural and co-cultural activities. So this is really a great opportunity for all of us to listen to him. As we know that this World Zoonosis Day, this is held every year on 6th of the July and marks a major breakthrough in the fight of different kinds of zoonotic diseases caused by germs that are spread between animals and human beings. And yet, 136 years later, despite of tremendous advances in science and medicine, the world is struggling to respond to the novel coronavirus and latest devastating pathogens to spill over from the animals. Regarding this parasitic zoonosis, which is the topic today, this is very much pertinent in today's occasion. And every time, because we are talking about bacterial zoonosis, viral zoonosis, but rarely we think about parasitic zoonosis. So I believe that this talk will certainly give better insight to all of us about the parasitic zoonosis. So without taking much time, I welcome again our expert, our speaker, today's speaker, and welcome everyone, and hope certainly we'll get benefit, we'll have a new idea about this topic. So welcome again. Over to Dr. Kaushik. Dr. Kaushik, please.
Thank you, sir. So without wasting much time, everybody wants to listen to Dr. Banerjee, the today's guest speaker. So may I request Dr. Banerjee, sir, to start your lecture and shower us, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kaushik and Dr. J.K. Prasad, Dean, Bihar Veterinary College. I am really very proud to accept your invitation for this lecture on the auspicious occasion of World Zoonosis Day. I am also thankful to the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rameshwar Singh, and Dr. Veer Singh, the DRI, and all other officers and faculty of Bihar Veterinary College for giving me this opportunity. I also welcome to my talk all the audiences, including some of my past students. Dr. Prem Sagar, I'm really happy to see you after a long time. Dr. Sujit, my old student from Panthnagar, and there might be many more. Dr. Sanjay Bharti and Dr. G.D. Singh, etc. Now, coming to the topic, parasitic zoonosis, frequently encountered in animals but obscure in humans in India. I had to struggle to prepare this lecture. It is not a ready-made lecture that foodborne zoonosis or zoonosis from animals, from waterborne zoonosis or something like that. I have chosen this topic because I wanted to avoid any repetition. If I go for foodborne zoonosis, you know what will come up. And those are all very well-discussed topics like echinococcosis or hydatidiosis, tiniosis or cysticercosis, toxoplasmosis, etc. We have discussed in detail in many forums. But I have chosen the topic knowingly that I will face some problem in compiling the information. Frequently encountered in animals. There are many zoonotic parasites which are frequently encountered in animals. But when it comes to its existence in humans, we do not have really very good data to support that they are real zoonoses. For example, when I used to teach parasitology, or when I was a student of parasitology, we knew that human visceral leishmaniosis or kalazar, which was very much prevalent in Bihar and also in West Bengal, the Dumdum fever, it is not a zoonosis in India. This was the concept, but the scenario is changing. There is an article from All India Institute of Medical Sciences where they have collected, under the leadership of Dr. Sharman Singh, they have collected samples from sheep, goat, dogs from endemic areas of Kalazar, and found that some of the goats, they were positive serologically as well as for the DNA of Leishmania donovani. So we have to rethink whether our past concept or whether our existing knowledge about zoonosis and its animal reservoirs are really true, or we are still floating and there are scope of further research. I think I have conveyed why I have selected that frequently encountered in animals. I will discuss only about few of them, not all, the parasitic infections of animals which are frequently encountered, but the human infections are not very clear or not very prominent. There are stray incidences of these infections. Now, if we look at the reasons of growing concern about zoonosis, then we will come down to few points which are conventionally taught to the zoonosis students, like the habitat change. There is a change in the habitat of animals and also human beings. Deforestation, rampant deforestation and urbanization. I want to go back to my Panthnagar days when I joined in 1991. We hardly ever used to go to Rudrapur, which is a distance of around 15 kilometers. And if there is some urgency, we used to go in the daytime, and before evening we used to return, because just beside the road there were dense forests. Now in 2010, when I visited that particular place again, I found there are no forests at all. All wiped off, and there are industries and the roads are so big, it is really very difficult. So you think about the animals which used to inhabit in these forests, they are all driven out, and they sometimes infiltrated into human dwellings, and deforestation and urbanization is one of the major causes of spreading zoonotic diseases. Climate change is another, where due to climate change, there is increased incidence of vectors and the vector-borne zoonosis. Pollution, development of drug resistance. Yes, the drugs which were very much effective against some of the parasites, they are now resistant to the drug, and so have an upper hand to be disseminated in an uncontrolled manner. Globalization, increased trade, travel, and human as well as animal movement. You will not believe, people are so crazy that they are bringing pets from European countries, particularly dogs and cats. And few days back, I had the opportunity to see the blood smear of one dog, where we could identify some Leishmania-like organism. We were not very certain that these are Leishmania, but yes, Leishmania was one of the our suspect. And PCR-based diagnosis, it was confirmed that this was Leishmania. Leishmania in the visceral organs in a dog is not a common thing in our country. Nobody will say that Leishmania means the visceral Leishmania or Leishmania donovani can cause in a disease in dog. And when we went back to the history of that dog, it was imported from some other country. So human as well as animal movement is also very frequently occurring in our country. And then another very important issue is HIV/AIDS, which causes immunosuppression, and also other diseases like which causes immunosuppression, including COVID-19. Probably you are aware that few days back in Gangaram Hospital of Delhi, 5 patients were suffering from rectal bleeding and they zeroed down to one infection, CMV, cytomegalovirus, which is very commonly found in humans, but is not a causal agent of any disease in these cases. But these COVID patients, due to immunosuppression, there was intense bleeding from the rectum, and one of the 5 patients succumbed to this infection. So increased immunosuppressive diseases will again further increase the incidence of parasitic zoonosis also. War and civil unrest is another reason when there is minimal public health attention, and most importantly, failure of the policymakers to develop a policy which can be used for the control of zoonosis diseases. Now, you all know that zoonosis...
Is the slide mode, may kindly put in slide mode, sir. That will be more better visible.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It's better, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. And the role of the veterinarians is immense. The veterinarian is responsible not only for the animal health component, but they are also very active in protecting our theme of the day, that is One Health. And human health and environmental health is all interrelated. The veterinarians have a major role to play. Now I want to come to few infections which are frequently encountered in animals. One such is Fasciolopsis busca infection. And it is a very large, thick-shed fluke, which is found in the intestine of pigs. Around 30 to 35% of the pigs slaughtered in different states are infected with Fasciolopsis busca. And water chestnut, Singara, this is the water chestnut, which is supposed to be one of the major sources of infection for humans, because in the water bodies where the water chestnuts are grown, there, if the pigs enter and defecate, then the eggs of this parasite are released, and then the miracidium, which comes out from the egg, penetrate the snail, and then after multiplying inside the snail, the cercaria comes out, which encysts on the surface of these water chestnuts. And you know, in Bihar and in West Bengal and also in Assam, there is no concept of boiling water chestnut and eating it. We generally take it raw as a fruit, and it is also offered as a fruit, as a prasad in many of the pujas. Now, the children who find it difficult to peel off the outer covering of the water chestnut, they generally use their teeth to peel off. And when it put on the mouth, the metacercaria, which are adhered on the surface of the water chestnut, are ingested. And this leads to the adult worm formation in the intestine. Around 60% humans were found infected in Assam. And often they were concurrently infected with gastrodiscoides hominis. This is another fluke which is found in the large intestine of pigs as well as human beings. This infection has already parts of eastern UP, Bihar, Assam, West Bengal, and Odisha. Now, if we look at this life cycle, the pigs are the major hosts or the natural hosts. And the eggs come out, then the eggs, miracidium comes out, infect the snail. After going through the multiplication on the snail, the cercaria comes out with the help of the tail, it swim in the water, and then they shed the tail and the metacercaria are attached to the grass blades or the water chestnut. And we pick up the infection by ingestion of this. Now, in the real scenario, if you pick up a leaf from the water bodies or the water chestnut, you may find some brownish dots. These are the metacercaria attached. If you use a hand lens, you can find these metacercaria on the surface of the water chestnut. And these are the source of infection for humans. Now, I know about one case which was treated in All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And one of my friends from the microbiology department of AIIMS actually gave me this video, which is an endoscopic picture of a 9-year-old girl who was suffering from severe abdominal pain and diarrhea. And when the diagnosis was not done correctly, after that, the endoscopy revealed something which will be astonishing for all of us. You please look at this endoscopy, and this is the pink colored wall of the intestine, and the white colored structures, lighter colored structures, are the adult flukes in the intestinal wall. You can see that the whole intestinal wall is almost carpeted. There is a carpet of Fasciolopsis fasciae. And when the diagnosis was done, treatment was initiated immediately. However, unfortunately, this patient could not be saved. So it depends upon how many metacercaria are ingested by the man or the human patient. It depends upon the number of metacercaria. The number may be very high if many water chestnuts are peeled off by the teeth and they are ingested. Now I will come to another vegetation-borne infection, that is fasciolosis. We all know fasciola is ubiquitous in many parts of our country, and the prevalence may vary from 0 to 60 or 70% in animals, ruminants, particularly cattle, buffalo, sheep, goat, though it is occasionally also found in horses and dogs, but these ruminants are the major reservoir or the natural hosts. In our country, we have Fasciola gigantica and Fasciola hepatica, and snails act as the intermediate host. Almost the life cycle is similar to Fasciolopsis fasciae. Here, the ruminants are the major hosts. Eggs come out, and then the snail plays the role of a multiplier, where the parasites multiply. Ultimately, the cercaria come out, which insists on the vegetation nearby the water sources, and ingestion of the metacercaria, just like Fasciolopsis, with the contaminated food and water. Food and water, yes. Sometimes in rural areas, pond water is taken by many people because there are scarcity of potable water, and this may lead to infection. Major health issues in Andean countries like Bolivia, Peru, Western Europe, Iran, and Turkey. From our country, we have very few sporadic reports of fasciola infection. And mostly it is Fasciola gigantica in the plains, and in temperate Himalayan hill states like Jammu and Kashmir, and also Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand, we have Fasciola hepatica also in very restricted areas. Both of these parasites have got tremendous potential of infection to humans. Now, this is the fasciola we collected from a buffalo, and this is the large fluke. This is Fasciola hepatica, and this is Fasciola gigantica. And when the multiplication in the snail is over, then from the snail, the cercaria comes out and swims in the water. These are the minute cercaria which are swimming in the water with the help of the tail. And after some time, they shed the tail and encysts in the grass blades as metacirculi, or may even encyst in the water without any grass blade. So the sometimes the vegetation around the water sources are used as starch in our diet, and they are the source of infection for humans if it is not cooked properly. When these metacirculi are ingested, then in the intestine, with the help of the bile and other salts, they are enzymes, they are excreted, and immature flukes come out from these and they penetrate. These are the immature flukes, and they penetrate the intestinal wall and they travel to the liver surface where they cause severe damage. This is the liver of a buffalo, which is penetrated by the immature flukes, and there is severe hepatitis due to migration of these immature flukes. Similar condition may happen in case of humans. If a great number of metacirculi are ingested, then the liver will be severely damaged. If the patient survive, if the animal survive, then ultimately they reach the bile duct where they become adults. And that leads to chronic fasciolosis. So these are the two fluke infections which are very commonly found in our animals. If you slaughter pigs, then around 30% of the pigs have got Fasciolopsis buscae. And if it is ruminant, then around 60 to 70% of the animals in some of the endemic areas are infected with Fasciola gigantica or Fasciola hepatica. I will now switch over to another nematode, which is very common in our dogs, cats, and also wild carnivores, foxes, and other wild carnivores. And that is Toxocara canis. In case of felids, it is Toxocara cati, and Toxascaris leonina in both dogs and cats. There is another nematode, Nathostoma spinigerum, Capillaria hepatica, which have been incriminated in a condition known as visceral larva migrans, which happens in human beings. High prevalence is found in dogs and cats and their wild counterparts. The pups actually acquire the infection of this Toxocara canis from their mother or the bitch through transuterine route or through transmammary route. That means when the pups are born, either they are already infected or they pick up the infection by suckling the mother. And the milk, which is taken by the mother's milk, which is taken by the young pups, that lead to the infection. Ultimately, adult worms are formed. These are the adult worms of Toxocara canis. And then the eggs are excreted in the feces. The eggs are very much resistant to environmental condition. They can survive very, very long time because of a thick wall, thick eggshell. And then ultimately, a larva is born inside the eggshell, and then it molds to larva 2. And this larva 2 containing egg is the source of infection for, or is the infective stage for humans as well as dogs. And we all know, because of many reasons, there are plenty of dogs, or stray dogs rather, in the vicinity of our dwellings. And they are defecating in the garden or in the park. And we are using our shoes. And when we come back to our home, then we rub the shoes in the doormats, which is a major source of infection for humans, particularly children who are at the stage of oral exploration. There is a stage when there is teething. Everything is explored by the children by mouth. By mouth, not by eyes. We explore by our eyes, adults. But the children at that age, they put everything on mouth. So some of these eggs may be there in the doormat, and that can be ingested by the children. And they are the worst sufferers. Now, in IVRI, one of our PhD students, Dr. Anju Varghese, was doing her PhD work on visceral larva migrans with an intention to develop a recombinant protein-based diagnostic test which can be used in dogs as well as in case of human being. And experimentally infected mouse with the embryonated eggs of Toxocara canis. Then slaughtering the mouse at different stages of infection, we used to slaughter them and find out the larva in different organs, the liver, kidney, and lungs, and all other, including brain. And we found that in the brain, the concentration of the larvae is maximum. And this is one larva found in the brain of one mouse. Same thing happens if a human being ingests the egg containing the larva too. And in the liver, lungs, and kidney, these larvae, they remain encapsulated and they ultimately die, leading to a condition known as larval migrants, visceral larval migrants, the visceral organs. They never reach adulthood in abnormal host-like human beings. They die either in the liver or in the lungs or in the kidney, and a multisystemic disease may be produced. Seroprevalence of this infection has been detected in northern India by one group of PGI Chandigarh, and the pathological entity consists of enlarged liver, pulmonary infiltration, intermittent fever, loss of weight, persistent cough, very high persistent circulating eosinophilia. More than 50% of the circulating white blood cells are eosinophils. This type of high eosinophilia should give an impression or should be suspected for visceral larva migrants. Eye lesions are also not common. That's why it is also known as ocular larva migrants. And the eye lesions resemble with one cancerous condition, retinoblastoma, which needs enucleation of the eyeball. So this should be differentiated from retinoblastoma. Now I am coming to another infection which is frequently encountered in dogs and also cats and wild carnivores in our country, and that is dirofilariosis. There are three species which occur in dogs and also in human beings. They are Dirofilaria immitis, Dirofilaria repens, and Dirofilaria tenuis. They are mostly involved in human cases. Dirofilaria immitis, you all know, is also commonly known as heartworm of dog. And it is most common in dogs, though raccoons and cats can also be infected. Alarmingly increasing trend of human cases points toward a need for control of this parasite in animals. There are increasing incidences of dirofilariasis, and whenever a dog is suspected with dirofilaria, we can prepare a thick smear and can demonstrate the microfilaria in blood, thick blood smear, or we can plasma or the buffy coat area where the moving larvae can also be detected. These are the microfilaria or larva one stage. Now this is the heartworm. The adult heartworm may reach up to 1 foot, 12 inches, and the males are a bit shorter, around 8 inches, 6 to 8 inches. And they are found either in the pulmonary artery or in the right side of the heart and cause severe conditions in dogs. And there is exercise intolerance, soft cough, then ascites in dogs. So in these cases, dirofilaria infection is suspected. Now these are transmitted by mosquitoes. The common mosquitoes what we encounter in our life, Anopheles, Culex, Aedes, Mansonia, Armigeres, all these mosquitoes, they act as the intermediate host. And they pick up the infection when they bite a dog, then the microfilaria is ingested and they develop in the Malpighian tubule of the mosquito. When this mosquito again bites another dog or a human being, they don't discriminate. The mosquito which bites a dog also bites a human being. Is there any law that it should not bite in human being? No. So they have the liberty to bite a human being also. And at that time, the larva 3 stage is inoculated, which never reaches adulthood in human being. After staying for the muscles for a few months, they reach the lungs. And there, in case of humans, it is the accidental host and dead end host. The parasite never reaches adulthood. Human dirofilariasis is typically manifest as either a subcutaneous nodule or pulmonary disease. If it is a subcutaneous nodule, mostly which is caused by dirofilarial rifens, then it is not very much serious. It is restricted to that part. Then the larva dies and ultimately the nodule persists. And until and unless that nodule is dissected, the parasite cannot be demonstrated. But if it infects the lungs, which is commonly found in case of dirofilaria emetis, then it may lead to a serious disease in humans. And typical Cohen lesions are seen in lungs, which may be confused with some of the lung cancer. And it must be differentiated from lung cancer because it does not require the surgery of that affected portion. From India, there is increasing incidence, especially from Kerala, Karnataka, Odisha, and Assam. I think it has not been investigated properly in human cases from other states because dirofilaria is very common in all other states, including Uttarakhand and Uttar Pradesh, where I have worked since long. Now, human cases, it has been reported from many European countries, Asia Minor, including India and Sri Lanka. And the common clinical signs include abnormal cough, coughing up of blood, chest pain, wheezing, chills, fever, and the chest X-ray may reveal typical Cohen lesions. So this must be differentiated from cancerous conditions of the lungs. Now I am coming to another parasite on which we were working. I was working along with Dr. Hira Ram at IVRI. Now after my transfer to Kolkata, I am still involved in screening of the samples. And this parasite is Strychnine. It is also found in animals. And I tell you, we do not know the actual picture of animal infection of Trichinella species. When we examine the wild animals, particularly the tiger, the leopard, and also the hyena, and wild pigs or boars, we found almost all are infected with this parasite. Almost all. Only one or two. So far, we did postmortem examination or tissue examination of wild animals of at least 50 animals from different parts of the forest of Uttarakhand and Uttar Pradesh. And almost all are positive for Trichinella species. This parasite is a typical parasite. It is a very, cunning parasite. And these are all the infections, all the animals which may be involved, including the rats and the pigs. Now, if it is in the wild, then it will circulate in the wild between the carnivores and the herbivores, particularly omnivores like pigs. But in the fringe areas, where a forest area is surrounded by or is margined by a village, then it may jump into the domestic cycle. How? If there is a dead body of a pig or wild boar, then that can be eaten by a rat. The rat will not discriminate between a forest and domestic area, and it may enter into the domestic cycle where this rat may be ingested by another domestic pig, which may be infected. And humans become infected by ingestion of mostly pork. But I know about some of the tribes in our country who kills rats and ingest it, especially in some of the tribal population. So they have got a better or greater chance of getting infected with Trichinella disease. If the pork is not properly cooked, and if it contains the encysted larva of Trichinella, then humans become infected and they become clinically ill. One outbreak was reported from Uttaranchal, where around 74 people did a feast with a boar which was killed in the forest. And all 74 became ill. They were admitted to different hospitals. And 12 out of them were dead. Some of them died in Safdarjung Hospital. So this is a very serious infection. Animal infection is very common. I am not talking about domestic pigs. It is very rare in domestic pigs because surveillance is going on at IVRI and also Mumbai Veterinary College. They could find only a handful of domestic pig infected Trichinella. But there is of spillover from the sylvatic cycle to the domestic cycle through the rats, and it may jump to human beings. Now, while doing research at IVRI, we could find encysted larvae in the muscle of wild pigs. These are the larvae which were digested from the muscle, and in the microscope, they look like this, and they are all live larvae. This parasite is so typical that if an infected animal dies, then when the muscle is rotten, there is absolutely autolysis of the muscle. Even then, the parasites are live. They remain live for a very long time in the muscles. And as far as live animals are concerned, it has been proven that as long as the domestic or the wild animals are live their whole life, these larvae may also remain live. Now, I am coming to one rickettsial organism. I have skipped protozoa because you see the zoonotic protozoan infections like toxoplasma, like babesia. Babesia is a zoonosis, but in our country, we do not have those two species which are mostly involved in zoonotic babesiosis. One is Babesia microti, and another one is Babesia divergens. Another third species, Babesia duncani, has also been incriminated in human cases. And very recently, Babesia bovis was found in few human cases. None of these species occur in India. So I have not touched it. But there are increasing incidents or reports of the occurrence of Babesia bovis in our country. We have reported from IVRI Aizatnagar that there is some evidences of Babesia bovis infection in animals in Uttar Pradesh. Similarly, NIAB, National Institute of Animal Biotechnology, Hyderabad, they have also reported there are some gene bank submissions from that group regarding the occurrence of Babesia bovis in India. Now, toxoplasma is much talked about, so I have not touched toxoplasma. Rather, I have concentrated on one rickettsial organism, which is recently seems to be an increasing incidence. I am not sure whether it is an increasing incidence or whether it is an effective diagnosis or efficient diagnosis of the present generation vets. This Ehrlichia canis is very frequently seen in dogs. This is one monocyte in the cytoplasm. You can find one aggregate of cocci. This is actually a new bacteria. This is the morula of Ehrlichia canis. This is transmitted from one dog to another dog by one tick, sanguineous, and another parasite.
संबंधी अर्थ नहीं निकले
एनाप्लाज्मा फेगोसाइटोफिला which is not conclusively been proved from India, but there is increasing evidence that this organism also occur in our dogs, and these two organisms have the potential to infect humans. There is not a single case of humans infected with Ehrlichia canis, but there is evidence of Ehrlichia canis infection in Venezuela and some other South American countries, while Anaplasma phagocytophyllum has been reported from humans in most of the European countries. Now, this is another blood smear where you will find that this is a monocyte, this is the nucleus of the monocyte, and in the cytoplasm, there are two moruli of Ehrlichia canis. Here, in the monocyte cytoplasm, there is one morula. These are all Ehrlichia canis moruli, which was proven by us by morphologically as well as by molecular biological techniques. Now, if this happens in human beings, then the diagnosis will be very difficult because we see what we know. This is the quote of one of my teachers who taught me parasitology in postgraduate level. And he used to say repeatedly that, Dr. Banerjee, we see what we know. We don't see what we don't know. In this virtual meeting, there are around 180 participants, but I could find only Dr. Ajit, Dr. Prem Sagar, and Dr. Sujit, and Dr. J.K. Prasad, and Dr. Veer Singh. Others, I am not actually familiar so much. Dr. Purushottam Kaushik undoubtedly is known to me. So I could find them and I could identify them. Others, I am not aware. Who are they? They are participants. So my contention is that if you know that these are the parasites which occur in animals and these are the locations, then you will identify. If you don't know, then you will fail to identify. And that is probably the case in most of the human cases. Human pathologists, if they are aware that this type of intracytoplasmic inclusion in monocytes and neutrophils might be a rickettsial organism, then they also will identify, and more human cases will be reported. I am almost at the end of my lecture because I committed that I would take only 40 minutes. It is exactly 40 minutes and 28 seconds. Lastly, I like to tell that recently I came across, it is in 2021, I came to one report or one article, foot and mouth disease virus infection in domestic dogs. All the vets present in this meeting, have you ever heard about foot and mouth disease in dogs? Have you heard about it? No. And this group from Iran, they conclusively proved that when the pups were fed with sheep meat, which were suffering from FMD, they suffered from the infection and some of the pups died. What I want to mean that the parasites, which are not known to infect human beings, may also jump the species barrier in coming days or coming years and may establish themselves in human beings. So the sphere of zoonosis will increase. This is just an example. I am not talking about humans. So this is just an example. And we have already seen that Trypanosoma lewisi, which is a very much host-specific trypanosoma of rats, have established in at least 12 to 13 cases of humans. And this Trypanosoma lewisi is so much host-specific that it does not develop even in mouse, in different breeds of mouse, but it could infect the human beings. This jumping the species barrier is really, and it is a matter of study. The group who were in South America, they were studying this jump of the species barrier, and they found that from the rats, the parasites were transmitted firstly to the monkeys and established in the monkeys. From the monkeys, it jumped to humans. So this happened in coming years and coming days. I wish that I could do at least I could generate some interest in some of the parasitic diseases which are frequently encountered in animals but are rarely found in human beings. So with this, I thank all of you again for your vision, for your patience, your hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful and full of knowledge presentation on the topic. So if anybody has any question, any clarity, they can ask in chat box.
Dr. Purushottam and Dr. Ajit, I am following the chat box. If there is any, then you can please put the question to me.
Presentation
बंद करो.
Yes, sir. Yeah, please.
Okay.
Chat box.
There is some sound from Vivo 1820. Vivo 1820.
I think no questions in chat box. So directly questions could be asked. If anyone is having any clarification, any question, because this is a great occasion that we have Encyclopedia of Parasitology in front of us. So kindly ask the question. This is a high time.
No, Dr. Jaikishan, this is inspiration.
No, sir, I understand. This is sincerity, the simplicity in you. So, please, sir,
thank you.
Any question?
Am I audible?
Sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
I am Dr. Purushottaman, retired director of Animal Health, TANVAS. Yeah.
I think
this is a great occasion of World Zoonosis Day. We had a very good lecture from Dr. Banerjee. Very interesting news is about the foot and mouth disease in dogs. Because it is known that cloven-footed animals only affected by this disease. But there is an open access article which was shown in the lecture that it was recorded in the myocardial tissue of the canine species. So it will be very interesting to further study for the youngsters, carry on, because it may be a host to carry the virus to transmit to the ruminants. Very interesting topics which you have discussed, away from the viral diseases. You have discussed of the genetic parasitic diseases. Now you know mucormycosis, black fungus, is taking a heavy toll on COVID-infected patients. So it is the duty of the veterinary mycologists also study on this fungus, genetic fungus, and work on this in addition to the other zoonotic diseases like rabies, anthrax, etc. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And all the best for your future endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So there is a question in the chat box from Anikesh Ramesh. Sir, I have one question. Trypanosoma evansi transmitted in humans as recorded in Maharashtra recent. Do we have any update?
Anikesh, there are total 4 cases of trypanosoma evansa infection in humans. Am I audible?
Yes, audible, please.
Okay, so there are 4 cases of trypanosoma evansa infection India and Indian subcontinent, and one is from Sri Lanka. This is the earliest one. Then another one from Maharashtra, Chandrapur district of Maharashtra, and this infection was recorded in a herdsman, and he was a quack, and he was suffering from trypanosomosis. After much study, molecular level study, it was found that this was trypanosomosis. That man was cured after treatment. Then the third case was recorded from this state, my state, West Bengal, Kolkata, and a lady was suffering from trypanosomosis. It was diagnosed by School of Tropical Medicine, Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, and some other laboratories also. But I am not sure whether it was trypanosoma evansi or some other trypanosome, because no particular study was carried out. This is the third case. And the fourth case is again from Maharashtra, from Mumbai suburb, which was a patient who was pregnant in advanced stage of pregnancy, and also she was suffering from HIV/AIDS. This infection was detected some pathologists, and without proper identification, they declared it as trypanosoma evansi. The criteria which was followed was the morphology and culture in a meter, which is not conclusive. So this is about the some of our knowledge about trypanosoma evansi infection in India and its Indian subcontinent. These are the 4 cases. 4. One is from Sri Lanka, one from Maharashtra, and another one is from Kerala. As we know that almost 30%, 20 to 30% of the animals, of farm animals, are suffering from either chronic or acute trypanosomosis all over India. But it is not found in animal humans, because humans are endowed with a God-given gift, that is, they contain, or their serum contains, one high-density lipoprotein, which is known as ApoL1. Apolipoprotein 1. The humans have this component, which is trypanocidal for trypanosoma evansi. That's why humans do not generally suffer from trypanosomosis. But if there is manipulation, or their genetic deficiency, or there is mutation of that particular gene, then that human being may be vulnerable to trypanosoma evansi, as is the case in immunosuppressed individuals. Okay? Okay, Dr. Aniket?
There is one more question, sir. What is the reservoir host of Leishmania donovani for human beings?
Pardon?
What is the reservoir host of Leishmania donovani for human beings?
In case of other countries, South American countries and Central American countries, there is a dog which is the reservoir host, and also some rodents which may act as a reservoir host. But as I was telling you, from India, we do not have a very authentic report, excepting the one I cited, Dr. Sarman Singh from AIIMS. Previously, he was in AIIMS. Now he is in AIIMS Bhopal, director of AIIMS Bhopal. And his team, they found Leishmania donovani DNA and also antibodies in goats. So it may be, but we are not sure. We are not very certain till now. That's why Indian Kalazar is not considered to be zoonosis. But another Leishmania, which is found in India, which causes chronic leishmaniosis or cutaneous leishmaniosis, that is caused by Leishmania tropica, is a proven zoonosis. Dogs and gerbils act as reservoir hosts. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Somebody is asking: Is there any report of Fasciola hepatica and Gigantica zoonosis in India?
From India? Yes, there are. There are sporadic reports. I tell you, one of my friend from AIIMS, pathology department, he came to IVRI with a Fasciola Gigantica specimen. Because they are not very much acquainted with the morphology of Fasciola gigantica. So they came to IVRI in Dr. Raina's lab, Dr. O.K. Raina's lab, who was working on serodiagnosis of Fasciola gigantica infection in animals. And we identified that as Fasciola gigantica. The patient was from Eastern UP, and the serum of that particular patient was also positive with recombinant protein, natural protein of Fasciola gigantica, native protein of Fasciola gigantica in Dr. Raina's lab. So there are reports of Fasciola gigantica from India also. I will just interrupt Dr. Puri. Dr. Gyandev Singh, how he entered my late? He should be driven out. Dr. Gyandev, G.D. Singh.
You are mute. G.D. Singh, you are mute.
Namaste, sir.
Kaise ho?
Sir, badhiya, sir. Meri OPD thi, sir.
Understood. I know you are very busy. You are a very busy clinician like Dr. Pawde. You are the Patna version of Pawde.
Sir.
Okay.
Some more questions are also visible. Dr. Kaushik, kindly go through.
Yes, sir. There is a question.
Dr. Anish Yadav is an inquiry. Is it a published report, sir, regarding Fasciola case? No, it is not published. I believe I have no idea. But you can, if you are Anish Yadav from Jammu, then you please talk to your neighbor, Dr. O.K. Raina, who is residing in Jammu.
He will tell you in more detail. Sure, sir. Sure, I will do.
Sure. Are you from Jammu, Dr. Anish?
Yes, sir.
So there is only one Anish in veterinary field.
Yeah.
Only one Anish. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm the same Anish.
Okay. So you are the only one.
Yeah, because I wanted to listen your topic.
There is a query from Diksha Sharma. What is the mode of transmission of trypanosoma lewisi in human?
Doctor? Diksha Sharma.
Diksha Sharma.
Just a minute. The Trypanosoma lewisi is transmitted by a flea, F-L-E-A, flea, pissu, from rats to rats. And this transmission is not by the bite, but the defecation of the flea near skin puncture of the host. And if there is scratching, then that feces get entered into the punctured area where from the flea sucked blood. And thus the organism enters into the body of the host. Or if the flea is ingested in the rat, then also it can set up infection. Am I clear, Dr. Diksha Sharma?
Sir, there is an interesting question for you. that why some species of parasite is only zoonotic in nature? Why not all the species of a parasite?
This is a repeat question from Dr. Saroj. It was put to another speaker a month back, and so I will not answer it right now. I will answer it separately to him.
Okay.
It is a repeat question. I was present in that lecture also. So I will answer it again to Dr. Saroj personally. Sorry, Dr. Saroj.
So I think you have answered so many questions, sir, and there is so many questions listeners might be having.
I have provided my email ID as well as mobile number at the beginning of my lecture. So if anyone has got any further query, I will be happy to answer those. Because you know, sometimes your questions force us to read again and again and find out an answer. Many of the questions are not really, the answers of which are not really known to me. So I will read, search out, and then I will try to satisfy you. Namaskar, Dr. Veer Singh.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sharing your expertise and knowledge with the peoples like us. We have with us Dr. Professor Veer Singh, Director, Residence Instructor and Dean PG, Bihar Animal Sciences University. So we also like to hear something, few lines, few words from him also. Dr. Veer Singh, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kosik.
Before Dr. Veer Singh starts, I will give an introduction of Dr. Veer Singh. He is after me, he is present everywhere. Since my selection as senior scientist at IVRI, he was an expert. Then again, as principal scientist, when I was promoted, he was an expert. And then again, when I was selected as head of division, he was there. So he is after me. Sir, aaj to chhod dijiye kam se kam.
Thank you. Thank you, Banerjee sir. My dear friend, Dr. Banerjee, Dr. J.K. Prasadji, dear faculty members, and dear students. I am lucky today to hear a very good lecture. Although I have written a book on parasitic zoonosis, but the things he cleared, I am listening first time. So today's lecture is very, very informative. Very nicely, he did. Although there are 150 zoonotic diseases in the world, which are having, and out of that, one third is parasitic origin. And out of that, he covered only some helminthic infection, not all protozoan diseases. Protozoan diseases he has taken very lightly, and cryptosporidium, toxoplasma, then leishmaniasis, which are there, but they are remaining in silent form. Whenever there is AIDS or HIV infections, then they may flare up, then they may show the symptoms. So the diseases he's covered, fasciolosis, buscae fasciolosis, then visceral larva migraines, dirofilariasis, trichinellosis, ehrlichiosis, they are very covered very nicely, very, very nicely, how the disease is transmitted, how the disease they are causing pathogenism, mode of transmission, all the first time I am also listening from him. So Dr. Banerjee, really you need a very hearty congratulation for this today's lecture. Very nicely, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And that is the beauty of our respected teacher, Dr. Banerjee. That's why we are always fond of him as a teacher. When he taught us parasitology, we really loved him, listen him in so many topics. So now coming towards we are moving fastly towards the end of the program, today's webinar. Now I request our dean again to give his brief remarks, his closing remark on the present day.
Thank you, Dr. Kaushik. Already Dr. Veer Singh has given his remark. And the beauty of this talk is, I was just going through the talk and looking upon the number of participants. So in the beginning, when talk was started, there was total 192 participants. They carry on same in the midway. And just before 5 minutes of the talk, that was 191, means one participant was lesser. And now after end, 5 minutes after the over, this talk is over, that was 180 and now certainly has been reduced. So this is an indication how participants were involved in the lecture. This is their personal involvement in the lecture. So I must thank Dr. Banerjee for such an educative talk. And we could understand that how easily we could get ingested the parasites, how these parasites are dangerous for our health. So this was an eye-opener for all of us, for our students, for our faculty members, and for all of us. So this was a very good experience. I am very much thankful, and also thankful to our coordinators, Dr. Kaushik, Dr. Ranjay, Dr. Ajit, and grateful to Dr. Veer Singh for joining this program since very beginning. And thank you very much. One thing before end of this particular session, I'd like to, this is not a question, but just for educating me, Dr. Banerjee is here, and this is a right time to know about these things. Sir, about the abortion in case of the cattle generally, which is encountered during first trimesters of the pregnancy, and mainly this is being caused by trichomonas fetus. But what is the incidence? Particularly, I don't find any literature in our country, any report. So did you find any literature or anything about the incidence or any report of this very parasite?
Dr. JK, this parasite is, I can say the last report is from in 1970s.
From okay.
And then another report is in 80s or early 90s from Gadhvasu, at that time PAU. And they demonstrated the organism in cattle and also established the infection in rabbit. But continuous surveillance is going on at IVRI section and through culture method. But so far, none of the animals were found positive. So this is a parasite of minor importance, rather academic importance. So very little. No incidents or no study has been, no reports of trichomonas fetus from cattle or coffee.
Presently, we can say this is academic parasite.
Yes. Academic.
So thank you very much, sir. Thanks thank again you. For such a nice talk.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You. Dr. Kaushik.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Ajit, who is head of Department of Veterinary Parasitology, Bihar Veterinary College, to propose vote of thanks for the program.
Dr. Kaushik, first I would like to thank today's speaker and renowned parasitologist, respected Dr. P.S. Banerjee sir, for sensitizing and enlightening all of us about zoonotic parasitic diseases on the occasion of World Zoonosis Days. I hope this will be helpful for all of us to control the zoonotic parasitic disease. Then I'd like to thank to DRICOM BGS, respected Dr. Veer Singh sir, for your gracious presence and valuable remark about the webinars. I'd like to thank respected Dean Dr. J.K. Prasad sir for giving opportunity to organize such an informative webinar on the occasion of World Zoonosis Day. Last but not the least, I am very much thankful to all the participants from our university or different institute for your active participation. Thank you all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. JK, Dr. Bir Singh, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Patna Veterinary College.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Purushottam, Sanjay,
thank you, sir.
GD, Sujit, all of you. Ajit.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.